All right, welcome to the first session for the American Rankin Ray Society 2023. I have the pleasure of helping to moderate with Dr. Jungmin Lee here, our global exchange program with the Korean Society of Radiology. And today's topic, this year's topic, is going to be the changing paradigms in tumor response assessment. Thank you to Rankin Ray and Jorge Soto for the kind invitation. So the Rankin Ray Global Exchange Program is a long-standing program that's been built to help build long-standing relationships with key leaders and organizations in the world, wide imaging community, while raising the stature of our global partner societies among the American Rankin Ray Society members. And this year is the Korean Society of Radiology, first established in 1945. They have over 3,000 practicing imaging professionals, including 500 in training members. They run two journals, the Korean Journal of Radiology and the Journal of the Korean Society of Radiology. And I believe this year is the fifth collaboration now between the Korean Society of Radiology and the American Rankin Ray Society. I think the last meeting was the last collaboration was in 2017 with a breast imaging course. This year, we're going to be talking about cancer and cancer treatment and changes in the landscape of cancer treatment. So before we begin, I just wanted to give us a big picture of what's going on with cancer. It's still responsible for 1 in 6 deaths worldwide. There's almost 20 million new cases a year, 10 million cancer deaths per year. But the mortality has been improving over the last couple of decades, largely due to three things: decreases in smoking, improvements in early detection, and better treatment. And it's the latter trend that we're going to be looking at today. Cancer treatment in general had traditionally been the three arms of cancer treatment. Trying to switch slides here. Cut, poison, or burn, right? Surgery, chemo, or radiation. These have been the three traditional arms of treatment. But there have been a lot of changes in just these three very toxic treatment arms for cancer treatment. There have been a number of new precision cancer treatments out there. Today, we're going to be talking a little bit about immunotherapies in particular, as well as a little bit into discussion of theranostics. And then in terms of directed imaging guided therapies, we've got radioembolization and directed ablation, which we'll also be discussing in today's session. So just to top it off, these are our speakers for our topic today. Katie Krajewski from Dana-Farber is going to talk about assessment and toxicity in the era of immuno-oncology. Dr. Don Yu from Brown is going to be talking about the evolution of treatment response for prostate cancer in PET, a lot of changes there. Dr. Natalie Horvat from Memorial Sloan Kettering will be discussing restaging rectal MR, particularly in the era of watch and wait treatment. And then from the Korean Society of Radiology, we have Dr. Junil Choi, who will be talking about LIRADs for post-treatment response to hepatocellular carcinoma. Dr. Jin-Yung Choi will be talking about imaging evaluation after radioembolization, and Dr. Sang-Hyuk Lim will be talking about imaging evaluation after local ablation therapies. So, Dr. Krajewski, to begin. Thank you. It hit stop. Got it. Okay.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to present today. I have no conflicts of interest to disclose. During the following presentation, we'll discuss the spectrum of response and progression typically encountered in patients treated with immune checkpoint inhibitor treatment. And toward the end of the talk, we'll touch on chimeric antigen receptor or CAR T cell therapy. We'll also discuss the immune response criteria, specifically iRECIST, which is typically applied to patients treated with immune checkpoint inhibitor treatments. And also we'll identify some class-specific imaging manifestations of drug toxicity. To start, let's discuss the mechanism of action of immune checkpoint inhibitors to better understand the findings that we see on imaging of patients treated with these agents. Immune checkpoints are a normal part of the immune system. Their role is to temper the immune response so that it does not destroy healthy cells. Immune checkpoint proteins on the surface of T cells recognize and bind to ligands on other cells like tumor cells. And when the immune checkpoint protein and its ligand bind together, this creates an inhibitory signal in the T cell, and the T cell does not destroy the cancer cell, which can then evade the immune system. This is a figure taken from cancer.gov showing where immune checkpoint inhibitor agents act in this cascade. The immune checkpoint inhibitors are antibodies that bind to the checkpoint protein or to its ligand, preventing the checkpoint protein from binding with its ligand. The T cell then remains active and is able to destroy the cancer cell. MAB, or the MAB in the drug names, indicate that these are monoclonal antibodies. And this explains some of the findings that we see on imaging, because sometimes tumors can increase in size after treatment, which is thought to be related to immune infiltration. And the toxicities that we see are related to the immune system being activated. In various literature, imaging response patterns have been described, including early and complete response, so-called pseudoprogression, which is increase in size of lesions or new lesions followed by subsequent decrease, disease stability followed by ultimate response, mixed response with new lesions, and early progression. And as the spectrum of imaging patterns in response to immunotherapies was recognized, new response criteria were developed accordingly. The first such criteria was the immune-related response criteria described by Walchak in 2009, and subsequent iterations included immune-related RECIST and iRECIST. iRECIST, or immune response evaluation criteria in solid tumors, is a consensus-based guideline that was developed by the RECIST working group based on RECIST 1.1, and it's detailed in the Lancet Oncology paper cited here. Specifically, iRECIST addresses a limitation of the normal or usual RECIST 1.1, and the immune RECIST requires a confirmation of progressive disease to rule out or confirm pseudoprogression, which occurs in about 6% of patients overall. So it's rare, but important to recognize so that patients that are achieving a benefit from the treatment are not removed from effective therapy prematurely. The unique features of immune response assessment include how the new lesions are managed and the confirmation of progressive disease. New lesions are defined as measurable or non-measurable, and they result in unconfirmed progression. Also, we need a confirmation of progression of disease. So if a patient with unconfirmed progression is clinically stable and it's in discussion with the patient's oncologist, they can decide to continue treatment for a 4 to 8 week period, and additional imaging is then performed to evaluate for pseudoprogression or true progression. This is an example of a complete response to pembrolizumab therapy in a patient with metastatic urothelial cancer. This was a patient who had muscle-invasive bladder cancer in 2013, treated with cystectomy and ileoloop conduit formation. In 2018, he developed left supraclavicular and abdominal lymphadenopathy, which was FDG avid. He was treated with pembrolizumab therapy, and on follow-up imaging, there was normalization of the size and resolution of FDG uptake in the areas of previous lymphadenopathy, representing a complete response to treatment. And this patient remains in complete response today. This is another interesting example of a complete response, or at least a very deep partial response. This was an 85-year-old patient who was diagnosed with metastatic lung adenocarcinoma in December of 2017. He was actually offered hospice due to the amount of disease and his comorbidities. He had a large mass-like consolidation in the right upper lobe, innumerable bilateral pulmonary nodules, and lymphadenopathy. The patient was treated with pembrolizumab and had a fantastic response to treatment with near resolution of all of the findings. He continued therapy until 2019, stopped all therapy for approximately 8 months, and eventually developed recurrence in lymph nodes, which was again successfully treated. And the patient remains having an excellent response to treatment today. This is an example of a partial response to treatment in a patient with hepatocellular carcinoma treated with nivolumab. Patient had a large infiltrative mass in the right hepatic lobe and portal vein tumor thrombus, which significantly decreased on treatment. This is an example of unconfirmed progression in a patient with metastatic renal cell cancer with a metastasis in the left psoas muscle and left quadratus lumborum. Initially, this mass increased in size on treatment. Because the patient was clinically stable, the treatment was continued and follow-up imaging was performed, showing subsequent partial response. Many times, however, progression of disease is confirmed, as in this patient with metastatic renal cell cancer and left upper quadrant peritoneal metastasis. On first follow-up imaging, nodules increased in size, which then further increased in size on second follow-up imaging, confirming progression. Scan interpretation of patients treated with immune checkpoint inhibitors also includes evaluation for class-specific drug toxicities or adverse events. And in immune checkpoint inhibitor treatment, these can be clinically evident and wide in spectrum or clinically silent. And the caveat with the clinically silent is that we don't want to confuse these with possible progression. I've included the common terminology criteria for adverse events here, which is the grading system that oncologists use to grade adverse events, ranging from grade 1 mild, requiring observation, to grade 3 severe, resulting in hospitalization, or even grade 5 resulting in death of the patient. And the adverse events captured here include pneumonitis, hepatitis, hypophysitis, and colitis. This is an example of a clinically silent immune-related adverse event in a patient with metastatic renal cell cancer. At time point A, after 6 cycles of therapy, the patient was experiencing mixed changes. She had resolution of her retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy, but increased size of her primary mass. This was subsequently managed by nephrectomy and resumption of the immune checkpoint inhibitor treatment. The patient ultimately developed these hypodense lesions in the spleen and enlarged nodes in the mediastinum and hyla, and a sarcoid-like reaction was suspected. The treatment was held, and the patient was re-imaged, and all of those findings had resolved in keeping with the sarcoid-like reaction. In some cases, immune checkpoint inhibitor toxicities are biomarkers of treatment benefit, underscoring the importance of accurate recognition. For example, in this report of patients with melanoma treated with anti-CTLA-4 therapy, the patients who demonstrated radiologic evidence of immune-related adverse events had a higher disease control rate than patients who did not demonstrate radiologic evidence of immune-related adverse events. In addition, in another study, a small study of patients with metastatic renal cell cancer who had any tumor shrinkage and discontinued treatment for immune-related adverse events, 68% were able to keep their clinical benefit off of treatment for at least 6 months, and 36% had durable benefit and no treatment for 1 year. The next couple of slides illustrate the importance of accurate diagnosis of toxicity or lack thereof. This is a 30-year-old man with metastatic renal cell cancer with extensive disease in the right pleura at baseline and a normal appearing liver. After 6 months on treatment, we can see that he's had a nice response to therapy with decreased pleural tumor burden. At the same time, he developed right upper quadrant pain and elevated LFTs, in addition to a skin rash and ground glass opacities in the lung bases, which are not shown. On CT imaging, we can see the development of new periportal edema, enlargement of the liver, new convexity of this left hepatic lobe, and hepatitis was suspected and confirmed on liver biopsy. This is in contrast to this patient with metastatic urothelial carcinoma and a few small liver metastases. After 12 weeks on treatment, we can see that her liver has significantly increased in size and become much more heterogeneous. The possibilities of progression and drug toxicity were entertained, and a liver biopsy in this patient confirmed progressive disease. Given the dramatic increase in size of the tumor burden, the possibility of hyperprogression was considered, and this is a phenomenon of accelerated disease after the initiation of treatment, and there's some lack of consensus as to whether or not this truly exists or if it represents an aggressive disease biology. In the last few minutes of the talk, I'd like to discuss another type of immunotherapy, which is cell-based and called chimeric antigen receptor or CAR T-cell therapy. The first CAR T-cell therapy was approved in 2017, and now there are several FDA-approved treatments listed here. The suffix cell indicates a cellular therapy, and lu indicates white blood cells. The indication for these treatments include refractory or relapsed lymphoma, aggressive lymphomas, refractory or relapsed acute lymphoblastic leukemia, or refractory or relapsed multiple myeloma. These treatments are being investigated in other malignancies as well. And again, this figure is borrowed from cancer.gov, showing how the CAR T cell therapy is created. A patient's T cells are harvested, and then they are altered in a laboratory, whereby a gene for a special receptor called chimeric antigen receptor is inserted, usually using a viral vector. And that receptor is special because it can bind to antigen on cancer cells that are not presented by the MHC. Those cells are grown in a lab and then reinfused into the patient and may result in response in very heavily pretreated patients. And the response assessment in these patients depends on the underlying malignancy. This is a patient with lymphoma who was treated with CAR T-cell treatment. We can see extensive FDG-avid lymphadenopathy above and below the diaphragm. There was additionally some solid organ involvement and also bone marrow involvement. In this patient, the lead time for CAR T-cells was going to be about 6 to 8 weeks, so she underwent a bridging therapy and subsequently the CAR T-cell treatment. 30-day PET is commonly employed in such patients, which showed a complete response to treatment, essentially. There were a few small remaining nodes in the left axilla with uptake similar to the blood pool in keeping with the Deauville 2. This is a patient who did not respond as well to CAR T cells. This is a patient who had small lymphocytic lymphoma who developed Richter's transformation and diffuse large B-cell lymphoma with FDG-avid lymphadenopathy above and below the diaphragm and sites of marrow involvement. On the 30-day post-CAR T-cell PET CT, there were persistent avid nodes, some of which were increased as in the right axilla and subpectoral region, and some of which were decreased as in the mediastinum. Areas of marrow uptake were overall improved, but there remained intense uptake in the left femur in keeping with the Deauville 5. Two of the most common early toxicities of CAR T-cell treatment include cytokine release syndrome and immune effector cell-associated neurotoxicity syndrome. This is our patient with a Richter's transformation. She developed cytokine release syndrome grade 2 based on her symptoms and neurotoxicity grade 3. The findings on imaging in her case were very subtle with just trace effusions and a normal head CT. The patient can develop pulmonary edema, consolidations, and in the brain, sometimes white matter changes, leptomeningeal enhancement, hemorrhages, and infarcts. In the late term, patients are dealing with effects of B-cell aplasia, prolonged hypogammaglobulinemia and cytopenia, and infections. This is our patient who had a great response to CAR T-cells but developed a COVID-19 infection 5 months after her therapy and ended up in the ICU with progressively increasing lung consolidations. In the case of CAR T cells, the toxicities have not been associated with response to treatment. In conclusion, novel therapies in the era of immuno-oncology in general harness the power of the immune system to fight cancer. Each class of agent has its own mechanism of action. We talked about immune checkpoints and CAR T cells today. Each class is governed by a different response criteria and results in different toxicities. Applications and indications of the immune oncology agents will continue to grow, and as radiologists, we'll need to stay abreast of the new developments to serve our patients. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you for that excellent talk. So our next speaker is going to be Dr. Don Yu from Brown University, Alpert Medical School. He's going to be talking about the evolution of treatment response of prostate cancer utilizing PET CT. Thank you, Don.
Thank you, Kevin, for giving me a wonderful opportunity to speak here. And I want to thank the American Rank Raise Society. Also want to welcome all of our Korean speakers. This is not the first time the American Rank Raise and the Korean Society of Radiology have collaborated. And it's a wonderful opportunity to learn internationally. We learn so much more learning with each other than by ourselves separately. Okay, so with this, I would like to take you on a journey about the evolution of treatment response of prostate cancer utilizing PET CT. I know we saw a lot of great FDG PETs. We will not see a single FDG PET in my presentation today. My only disclosure, I'm a consultant for Invigro, which has nothing to do with my talk. So my objectives is I want to review the history of diagnostic radiopharmaceuticals used for prostate cancer, eventually leading to theranostics, as Kevin alluded to. And we're going to discuss PSMA imaging for treatment response. And this is still very early. There's a lot of new exciting changes, but we are not as well versatile in development of treatment response that, for example, as lymphoma, as in the earlier presentation. So if you look at prostate cancer statistics in the US, the incidence is number one in terms of cancer, about 290,000 cancers, and the death rate is number two, only second to lung cancer, about 35,000. The five-year survival for metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer is very poor, at only 15%. So if we look at the history of FDA approval in the US for diagnostic radiopharmaceuticals used for prostate cancer and also prostate cancer therapies, it's all happened in the last about 10 years or so. When I started residency, all we had was FDG PET, which is really has a very limited role for prostate cancer. And I was very jealous at Mayo Clinic was the first radiopharmaceutical, C11 choline, which is used for cell membrane synthesis overexpressed in prostate cancer. But they had a proprietary NDA, and they did not share that with anyone. The next year, very excited about having radium-223 used for metastatic disease of osseous mets and improved overall survival. And then it wasn't until 2016 that we had a universal radiopharmaceutical that we could all use for recurrent prostate cancer, F-18 fluciclovine, which is amino acid analog. And then in 2020, a lot of changes are happening. So we have gallium-68 PSMA, and this is FDA approved only at UCLA and UCSF, where it was really studied. But they did not do a non-disclosure, and they wanted to share this with everyone. The first commercial PSMA imaging that was universally available was F-18 PSMA. That was in 2021, and these are both kind of used interchangeably for initial staging and recurrent prostate cancer. And then shortly thereafter, in March of 2022, everyone had a lot of excitement because therapy for PSMA with lutetium-177 was FDA approved. And on the same day, with a little bit less fanfare, gallium-68 PSMA was also universally approved everywhere as well. So if you look at the NCCN guidelines, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, and I use this for a lot of different cancers, and prostate cancer, this is the latest iteration from the panel from September of 2022, but it's considered the 2023 version one. And if you look at, they talk about all of these radiopharmaceuticals available, and these are listed first because you can use this not only for recurrence, but also initial staging as well, compared to C11 choline and F-18 fluciclovine, which is only used for biochemical recurrence. These are superior to these radiopharmaceuticals below. So as I kind of alluded, I was very jealous because for a long period of time, the only radiopharmaceutical that was really great was C11 choline, but that was only at Mayo Clinic. One of my good friends, Mark Nathan, who was head of PET-CT, would share some of his cases. And this was a dramatic case of a patient that looked like had only self-limited osseous metastasis, but when they did a C11 choline, this patient had diffuse osseous metastatic disease. Here's a different patient, and the C11 choline looks very, very similar to PSMA imaging, but this patient had on the MIP image a single lymph node that was positive in the right hemipelvis here. And on MRI, there was no abnormality that they could discern. So this was a case, and we see this now with PSMA, where you have a positive nuke study or PET study and a negative MRI for metastatic disease in the pelvis and distant metastatic disease. So here's a patient who had a fluciclovine study. And this patient did have radiation to the pelvis. You can see there's photopenia in the pelvis. And there was no evidence of disease that we could definitely determine in this case. And this patient at this time had a PSA about 2. So this patient had systemic chemotherapy, initially did well. And this is kind of remarkable, but this was our very first PSMA study that we did at Brown. And it just happened to be this patient. And now we can see that there are 2 lymph nodes that show intense uptake. And this patient's PSA at this time was only about 1. So about half the PSA level, but we're seeing disease on the PSMA study. So if you look a little bit closer at the areas of disease, and here's just kind of a zoomed out image of that lower retroperitoneal lymph node, which is more intense. I'm just going to zoom it up. And you can see how intense it is in a PSMA compared to the fluciclovine study. And for you may wonder, oh, that lymph node looks like it got a lot bigger. On diffused image, it's very hard to tell. But if you take off fusion, you can see that lymph node is exactly the same in size. And there's no uptake on the fluciclovine study. Really remarkable. This really changed treatment on this patient. Instead of getting more chemo, he had targeted radiation to these levels that were involved. Here's the second level, smaller lymph node, also shows intense uptake on PSMA and no significant uptake on a fluciclovine study. So this has really changed the paradigm of prostate cancer imaging. Traditionally, what we use for local disease is MRI and transrectal ultrasound. That's still about the same, but in terms of regional spread of disease in the pelvis, CT and MR has been traditionally the way we image. And for distant disease, CT, MRI, and maybe bone scan for osseous disease. And now with the paradigm change of PSMA imaging, it's really taken over regional evaluation as well as distant metastatic disease. For local disease, MRI is still going to be superior. So if you look at the NCCN guidelines talking about this, and I thought this is really profound and really shows where we are now. And the latest guidelines, this is talking about CT and MRI, but it's saying alternatively, gallium 68 PSMA or F18 PSMA, PET CT or PET MR, if you have PET MR, can be considered for bone and soft tissue imaging. And also says in the bottom that it is not necessarily a prerequisite for PSMA PET and PSMA, PET CT, or PET MR to have CT or MRI, because PET can be as equally effective, if not more effective, for frontline imaging for these patients. So we've seen this in our practice. PSMA PET has really transformed how imaging is done. Instead of doing conventional CT or MR for regional distant disease, now we're doing PSMA PET. So this has led to the development of theranostics. And for those of you who have not heard the term theranostics, it's a combination of both therapy and diagnostic imaging. So this is kind of a play on words. This wasn't in the dictionary about 20 years ago, but the therapy part is the theranostics part, the beginning of the theranostics. And that's using a beta emitter or an alpha emitter, for example, lutetium-177 or actinium-225, which are both used for therapies. Actinium-225 is only available in Europe. And then using a diagnostic radiopharmaceutical, for example, FDA approval initially was gallium-68 PSMA-11. So this is relatively a new term. Again, in 1998 was the first time when someone was credited, and that was John Funkhauser, who was the CEO of Pharmanetics. And his vision was to use a radiopharmaceutical that had a chemical molecule that would attach a diagnostic radiopharmaceutical for diagnosis. Then you would switch out the radionuclide to a therapeutic radiopharmaceutical attached to the same chemical molecule for treatment, and then go back to the diagnostic radiopharmaceutical to follow up disease. So the important theranostics for prostate imaging all happened in the last couple of years. Again, gallium 68 PSMA-11, initially only FDA approved for UCLA and UCSF, but now universally approved in March of 2022. F18 DCYF PYL approved in May of 2021. And the therapy is the most important part now that we can do theranostics, approved in March of 2022. So this is a slide from my good friend, Phil Kuo, really showing how theranostic combines PET and radioligand therapy. So the thing to know about why PSMA is so good for prostate cancer is that the PSMA can be overexpressed in prostate cancer, sometimes even 1,000 times more than a normal a prostate cell. So you can really see intense uptake sometimes in small lymph nodes. You know, often like 4 or 5 millimeter lymph nodes can sometimes have intense uptake depending upon your PET scanner that you have. The only problem is that although aggressiveness increases PSMA uptake, at some point you can have neuroendocrine dedifferentiation and then your uptake can go down. And this is the therapy arm. So now what we're doing is targeting the epitope, in outside the prostate cancer cell, and this gets internalized within the cell and you can have effective treatment. So for a long time in the US, we did not have this FDA approved for therapy. So all of the studies that we're looking at basically theranostics were coming out of, majority came out of Europe, a lot out of Germany. And we're seeing cases like this where the patient was starting off with a PSA of 1200. And after just getting one treatment of lutetium 177 PSMA, they had a nice response. But look at how dramatic the response is after two cycles. It's almost like a PET 2 for lymphoma is my analogy. You can see if the patient's a responder or non-responder. We have to have some criteria, which we don't have for prostate cancer yet, we'll talk about. But after the course of treatment, after only 4 cycles, we traditionally are going to do 6 here, this PSA went down from 1200 to 13, and you can see how markedly limited disease the patient has at the end of treatment. So in 2018, at the Society of Nuclear Medicine and Molecular Imaging meeting, this was the image of the year, showing 8 different patients, all with different ranges of PSA and disease, and some of them dropped much more dramatically than others, but patients had disease up to almost 1,000 PSA and dropping to about 7. A few patients dropped, from, 15 to 100 to undetectable after completion of lutetium 177 treatment. Pretty remarkable. So this led to the U.S., to the VISION trial. This was a phase 3 trial looking at how effective PSMA is for therapy. And this was, there's a long history behind this and took about 3.5 years. I don't have time to go through it, but it's very interesting how we actually got this, approved. So about 2/3 of the patients got lutetium 177 PSMA as well as the best supportive therapy. And 1/3 only got the best supportive therapy. The primary endpoint was overall survival and secondary endpoint was progression-free survival. So if you look at overall survival, there's pretty dramatic, the median overall survival for patients who got the lutetium 177 was about 15.3 versus 11.3 months. And that's only about a 4-month survival, but that was very similar to radium-223. And if you look at a lot of chemotherapy trials, if you have this much, like 3 or 4 or 5 month survival benefit, that's a clear benefit to treatment. If you look at progression-free survival, it's a little bit longer, 8.7 months compared to 3.4 months. So this led, very exciting day. I still remember I was in a meeting with some of my friends and we were all very excited when we heard the news that on March 23rd, FDA approved not only lutetium 177 PSMA and then gallium-68 PSMA was also approved diagnostically, but really overshadowed by the therapy being approved. And if you look at how the FDA approved this therapeutic radiopharmaceutical, it really paralleled a VISION clinical trial. These are for patients who failed androgen receptor pathway inhibition and also had at least one taxane-based chemotherapy. So to put it in perspective, at what time point we're treating the patients, we're not treating the patients early on with lutetium 170 PSMA. It's for patients who have failed androgen deprivation therapy, they failed taxane-based therapy. So they're very close to death here. And this is where we're treating the patients with lutetium 17 PSMA. You can think about treating earlier, but at this point it's not approved. But that may be more for research in the future. So if you look at gallium-68 PSMA, that is how it was clinically approved. But people were worried, well, what if I do a diagnostic study with F-18-based PSMA am I still going to get that approved? And NCCN basically looked at that and said, although the FDA has approved gallium-68 PSMA for use of lutetium-177, the panel believes F-18 PSMA can also be used in the same space due to multiple reports with efficacy of the two imaging organ systems being very similar. And if you look at this is a small study looking at gallium-68 PSMA versus F-18 DCF PYL. The organ distribution of SEV is basically the same in terms of the degree of uptake. So this led to the first consensus statement about PSMA PET-CT response assessment. It came out of Europe in 2021. And they basically said, well, how can we define complete response? We're going to define it as disappearance of all lesions with tracer uptake. Partial is by reduction of uptake in tumor PET volume by greater than 30%, and stable disease is change of uptake in tumor PET volume with less than 30% without evidence of new lesions, and progression was appearance of at least two new lesions or PET volume increasing a progression of disease by 30%. So then this was a novel framework. This was an international multi-center study basically with UCLA and Germany, looking at RECIP, and that stands for Response Evaluation Criteria in PSMA Imaging version 1.0. And the primary outcome was overall survival, and secondary outcome was the prognostic ability of comparing RECIP versus just PSA alone versus combining the two. And so this is a really nice article, and this is for patients who had partial response. No one had complete response in this study after two cycles of lutetium PSMA therapy, but this is someone who responded. So they had greater than 30% decrease without new lesions. And if you look at patients who progressed, this was greater than 20% increase with appearance of at least one new lesion here. And so everyone who doesn't meet the criteria for partial response or progressive disease falls under the standard stable disease category. So if you look at overall survival, it's really depending upon whether or not you have lesions or no lesions. So dramatically, you can see about 20 months overall survival compared to only 9 months if you have new lesions. And you can see with the progressive, with a partial response, stable disease, and progressive disease, as expected, you're gonna have longer overall survival, the better your response is. It's also very important about PSA imaging. So for patients who had no PSA response, it turned out that patients who had partial response had a median overall survival of about 23 months compared to the patients who had no PSA response but did not have partial response on imaging. If you compare that to the patients with progressive disease who did not have PSA progression, the patients who did have progressive disease on PSA imaging had a very low median survival, 7.7, compared to the patients no PSA progression but did not have progression of disease. And so the last thing is, how can you combine these together? So, and which is better? So this was also came out of Germany, looking at prognostic volume, tumor volume, just came out in 2023, comparing both the consensus statement and RECIP. And what they found, if you look at these curves, it looks very similar. The only difference is that the stable disease, because this is a little bit more encompassing for RECIP, has a higher number of patients who fall into this category compared to the consensus statement. So what we can know, and what I'm trying to say, is that PSA is a very important biomarker. It's probably one of the most important biomarkers that we have. So the prognostic role of the interim PET-CT can really be effective, not only, I think, for lutetium-based PSMA therapy, but other traditional therapies as well. And this was talked about in one of the recent publications. So in summary, I took you on a journey talking about the history of diagnostic radiopharmaceuticals used for prostate cancer leading to theranostics, and we discussed PSA imaging for treatment response. It is not well-defined yet, but it's really going to be exciting to see how that evolves in the future. Thank you for your attention.
All right. Excellent talk, thank you. Let's see if we can switch our laptops. Oh yeah, you want to hit stop. So I have to hit play here.
We get this camera.
Okay.
Yeah. But simply. Simply. And I can hold the mouse.
Fair. Okay, our next speaker is going to be Dr. Natalie Horvat from the Dana-Farber, or sorry, from Memorial Sloan Kettering, and she's our last American slash Brazilian speaker for our session. She's going to be talking about restaging rectal MR in the new era of non-operative management. Thank you, Dr. Horvat.
Hi, good morning. Thank you so much for the invitation. I am very happy to be here with you today. And thank you so much for attending in person. I know that the day is beautiful outside, so I really appreciate that you are here today with us. Well, I have no conflict of interest related to this talk. And let's start by discussing about rectal cancer treatment, where we are. I know that there are different protocols. We will focus on the NCCN guideline. So as we know, patients with small rectal tumors like T1, T2, without nodal metastasis, without metastasis, they can be offered upfront surgery, including local excision if the tumor is very superficial with low risk of nodal mets. However, if we are dealing with a patient with locally advanced rectal cancer, then we can offer a neoadjuvant therapy before surgery. And the most common neoadjuvant therapy that we are used to is the CRT, the chemoradiotherapy. And the main goal of this treatment is to deal with the local disease and decrease the chance of local recurrence. And after surgery, depending on the pathology results, then the patient can receive systemic chemotherapy to deal with the systemic disease. However, recently, the total neoadjuvant therapy approach was published for different groups, and the idea is to bring the systemic chemotherapy to before surgery. And regardless the type of neoadjuvant therapy, after the end of the therapy, the patient is evaluated by a multidisciplinary team, especially rectal MRI and colonoscopy. And if there is any tumor left, surgery will be offered for the patient. And if there is no residual tumor and you are in a center with expertise on that, then the patient can be enrolled in a watch and wait approach and the surgery will be canceled. And that was initially described by Dr. Abergama in Brazil. And depending on the tumor, the patient can be offered a local excision as well. So different other studies was done to evaluate watch and wait approach. The one that was published last year, the OPRA trial, was a prospective multicentric trial led by Dr. Julio Garcia Aguilar and with more than 50 places in US. And the result showed more than 50% of organ preservation after total neoadjuvant therapy, which is good, very good. And the other recent results that probably you read about, Dr. Andrea Sursak published 100% of response, although 12 patients, but you know, very good response after PD-1 blockage in patients with MMR deficient, which can occur in around 5 to 10% of patients with rectal cancer. And this is huge because we are dealing with a very common tumor and the second leading cause of death in the world. So, and the other data that is important for us to take to have in the back of our mind is that although the total number of rectal cancer, colorectal cancer, is decreasing over time, there is a trend of increased incidence and mortality with patients less than 50 years old. So those advances are very, very, very relevant. So we started with the lecture itself. What the multidisciplinary team need to know from us after neoadjuvant therapy? If I can hear them, probably they will say something like that. Oh, it's not playing, but this is the music. You know that. And exactly that, they need to know if they will perform a non-operative management or surgery. And after 8 to 12 weeks after treatment, then the team will classify the patient into three different groups. Clinical complete response, and then the surgery is still the treatment of choice. If you are in a specialized center, then watch and wait can be offered. Near complete response, and you can offer close follow-up. Why? Because around 9% of those patients will end up with a clinical complete response. So giving more time, the radiation therapy will keep working the tumor, and then the patient eventually will have complete response. And the third group is clinical incomplete response, and then surgery will be the next step. Well, and what they need to know if they will plan a surgery? Well, they need to know how to achieve an R0 resection, how to resect the entire tumor. So it's our role to be a kind of GPS for the surgeon in order to describe all the sites of tumor and if there is any lateral pelvic side disease because they need to do additional resections. And going back to the first two groups, a patient that will be offered a watch and wait approach, it's not an easy task, like, okay, go back home, no surgery, and that's it. No, it's a long journey, 5-year journey. And especially in the first 1, 2, 3 years, this chance of tumor regrowth is higher. So in this initial, then the patient will undergo a digital rectal examination, CEA, endoscopy, MRI, and CT a little bit more frequently, around 3 to 4 months, except CT will be twice a year. Will be all like similar in 2 years. And after 3 years, those interval will get enlarged. And only after the 5 year, then the patient will be done with this watch and wait approach. So it's a long journey. So what do we need to know? Well, we need first know that we are not alone. I feel that sometimes when we are reading those patients, we are very anxious in trying to give the answer, but we are just a piece of the puzzle. And every time that MRI rectal is requested, it's not the only modality. We are together with endoscopy and DRE. And the other thing that we need to know is that primary stage MRI rectum is different from restaging MRI rectum in few topics, and I will try to summarize here. First, based on the protocol, on baseline, we need only T2. We are perfectly fine with the T2 to provide all the details. However, after treatment, DWI showed to add value in our evaluation, but not a regular DWI. We need to provide a specific protocol, and especially the microenema before the MRI showed better results. What is this microenema? Microenema is a small enema, 5 ml, immediately before the imaging acquisition, and the aim is to remove or reduce the gas in order to decrease the artifacts. The other topic, and it's a good news, after neoadjuvant therapy on restage MRI, we are better to evaluate nodes. We tend to be bad on nodes, but after neoadjuvant therapy, we are a little bit better. And here, the morphologic criteria is not that good, so we will rely on the tumor, on the nodal size in the short axis. And depending on the nodal location, then the cutoff will be different. If it's a TME node, it will be 5 millimeters, internal iliac 4 millimeters, obturator 6 millimeters, and the other ones will be the same criteria as we use for other nodals. Why we need to be aware of that? To avoid this kind of situation, like a patient with an obturator node is still positive after neoadjuvant therapy, it was not removed, and then the patient, unfortunately, 10 months after surgery, had the local recurrence. I would like to open a parenthesis here regarding this scenario that we are seeing more and more. If the patient is treating with a checkpoint inhibitor, such as the trial from Dr. Sursak, those lymph nodes can be enlarged, but in a reactive way. So if everything is going well, if the tumor is decreasing, if everything is going super good, if the only the node is getting bigger, just wait a little bit more. Probably it's only reactive. The other topic that is not that different from baseline, but I want to emphasize here, EMVI and tumor deposit also matters on restaging MRI. Don't forget about them. And just I put one case as an example. The patient has a beautiful response. Endoscopy was negative, but look at the extramural vascular invasion. This was not assessed on endoscopy, so it's why sometimes it's better to forget about the rectal wall for a moment and focus our attention on what is beyond the rectum. The other topics, the most challenging for us is how to now after restaging, we are dealing with fibrosis, and on imaging, it's very challenging to know if it's fibrosis alone or fibrosis with tumor. And we can use the TRG, it's used all over. That varies from 1 to 5, depending on the amount of fibrosis and viable tumor. But we know that it has a modest sensitivity and specificity and with variable inter-reader agreement. So what can we do to help T2? Because on T2, basically, it depends on the signal intensity. Fibrosis will be dark, and viable tumor will have intermediate signal intensity, right? So if it's not that helpful, so what can we do? We can add the DWI, and it was shown that increases the accuracy of MRI if we add DWI, knowing that fibrosis will not present restricted diffusion, but tumor will present. I know that in the lecture, sometimes it's easier, but in our daily life it's challenging. But we do need to improve our protocols and train our eyes. So I want to give you three steps before you start evaluating DWI. The first one is to ask yourself, is there any restricted diffusion? And that means bright signal intensity on DWI and low signal intensity on ADC. Why? Because there are two pitfalls that we should avoid. The first one is the T2 shine through. The shine through can happen in mucinous tumors, but also in the treatment response of the rectal wall. If there is edema post radiotherapy and edema, this can show T2 shine through. The other one is the T2 dark through. The fibrosis will be dark on DWI and ADC map. So it's why it's important to compare both of them. The other pitfall and the second step, is there any restricted diffusion within the tumor bed? So it's important to use the cross-reference lines and the triangulation. This is the first step when you are starting reading a restaging MRI rectum. So sometimes even the lumen can be positive, but actually we will compare the sequence and see that it's not within the rectal wall. And also this Merced band signs can help us. And three, this is one of the most important. If you are able to correlate the DWI with the T2, then we'll feel much more comfortable in saying that there is a viable tumor there. So use triangulation and be sure that that area corresponds to the T2. And eventually, our idea is to classify the patients into the three clinical relevant groups: complete response, near complete response, and incomplete. November 2022, and soon we will have more results. And what about the watch and wait? It's painful for the patient, it's a long journey, but also for us, we have to deal with so many scans. And I know that, so we have to compare. And small changes matter, and disagreement happens, and we have to be comfortable with that. This is the case that I like to show you. The patient was doing great with complete response, negative colonoscopy, with a beautiful scar, no restricted diffusion. And then the patient was in a watch and wait approach, and with the 12 months, nothing there, negative colonoscopy. 18 months, a small area, let me see if I can show here, a small area of restricted diffusion without a definite correspondence on T2. And the endoscopy was completely normal. What to do in that case? Well, early follow-up. If the patient is every 6 months following, we can push to 3 months. And that's okay, that's fine. The patient came back 3 months later and that area increased, and now we were able to see a correspondence in T2. But the endoscopy was negative and the patient was not comfortable with the surgery yet. Okay, it was offered more 3 months follow-up, and then the tumor increased, endoscopy was positive, and the patient was resected, the tumor was removed. And finally, mucinous tumors, they are challenging, MRI is limited, but we should at least try, and we are doing research on that. So just two examples. First patient, same appearance pre and post neoadjuvant therapy, acellular mucin, no viable tumor left. The second case, same thing, but with viable tumor left. So what we do now, we conclude MRI cannot differentiate cellular from acellular mucin. However, the data show that the prognosis, the overall survival of those patients are super comparable. And also some patients that deny resection, such as this patient, after 4 years, is still with sustained clinical complete response. So we don't have a good answer now, but we should at least try. Okay, so what do we need to report? We need first to review clinical information to know which type of treatment, the dates. We need to check the baseline MRI to be sure where the tumor was. Evaluate the tumor bed for primary tumor response. Check the relationship with the adjacent organs, because we are the ways for the surgeons. Evaluate the lymph node response, knowing that here the size criteria matters more than everything. Step 6, evaluate the MVI and tumor depositive. And 7, provide a clinically meaningful conclusion. So if we are dealing with a restaging step, we need to classify the patient into these three groups, as I mentioned. But if the patient is under non-operative management, we should provide, and this can cause confusion. If the patient didn't underwent surgery, then the terminology will be regrowth. And if the patient did any kind of resection or surgery, then will be recurrence. And if it's only in the rectal wall, we will call local. And if it's beyond the rectal, local regional. So based on that, we will classify no evidence or evidence of local or local regional tumor regrowth or tumor recurrence. So what is in the horizon? Well, first, we need to improve our communication with the team, and the standardized reports are here to stay. Radiomics and AI help us in several points, but one of these help us as an additional tool in that puzzle in order to detect the patients without tumor left, eligible for non-operative management. PET-CT, we are not that advanced as prostate, but new tracers are coming and maybe will help us in this evaluation. Use imaging to guide surgery. And also integrative models using multiomics, only not only from the tumor, but from the patient as a whole also. Towards a personalized medicine, because today we have so many different treatment options for the patient, and probably the image will serve as a biomarker to select the best treatment for that patient. And there is a hope. The overall survival of patients with rectal cancer is getting better. So what happened? There's a hope as yesterday, the beautiful rainbow as we saw yesterday, because we are dedicating a lot of time to integrate the radiology with the surgeons, with the oncologists, with the engineers, so that thing is helping the patient to survive more. So I would like to thank the DMMT from my hospital and also from Brazil, some of them. And thank you for being here.
Switching our laptops again.
Okay, I'd like to introduce the next speaker, Dr. Junil Choi from College of Medicine, the Catholic University of Korea. And he will be talking about application of LIRA to post-treatment response evaluation of HCC. Dr. Choi.
Thank you, Chairperson. Good morning, everyone. My name is Junil Choi from Seoul St. Mary's Hospital, Catholic University of Korea. It's my great honor to be a speaker at the ARRS Global Exchange Program. I look forward to more collaborations between ARRS and KSR in the future. Personally, thank you very much for inviting me to this beautiful island. The title of my talk today is Application of LIRA to Post-Treatment Response Evaluation of HCC. I have nothing to declare. My talk is divided into three parts. First, an overview of RIRA's treatment response algorithm, LRTRA. And second, diagnostic performance of LRTRA. And finally, strategies to improve the performance of LRTRA. Let's begin with the first topic, overview of RIRA's treatment response algorithm. The most widely used method to evaluate the tumor response to treatment are RECIST and WHO criteria. These criteria were developed to standardize the treatment response of a tumor in multicenter trials. WHO and the RECIST criteria only rely on tumor size change. However, in the case of HCC, it was necessary to measure the size of the viable tumor rather than the total size of the tumor in order to assess the response to treatment after local regional therapy and molecular targeted agent. Therefore, HCC-specific classification systems such as easy classification and modified RECIST were developed. And these methods measure the size of the arterial page hyperenhancement as viable tumor. All of you know, RIRA was developed for standardizing terminology and image interpretation in liver imaging and improve multidisciplinary communication to guide patient management. In 2017, the RIRA group published the RIRA treatment response algorithm. LRTRA, it can be applied in patients underwent local regional treatment for pathologically confirmed HCC or LR4, 5, or LRM malignancies. LRTRA would not be applied for treatment response assessment after systemic therapy. For patients underwent surgical resection or combination therapy of local regional treatment and systemic chemotherapy, LRTRA may be applied with caution. For example, recurrence at the surgical margin can be assessed by LRTRA. LRTRA can be used in multi-page CT or MRI with extracellular or hepatobiliary contrast agent. If treatment response cannot be evaluated due to image degradation or omission, these regions are assigned to LRTR non-evaluable category. If there is no region enhancement or only treatment specific expected enhancement pattern, such as thin and uniform peripheral enhancement around the treated tumor, LRTR non-viable category can be assigned. To assign LRTR viable, there should be nodular, mass-like, or thick irregular tissue in or around the treated region with arterial page enhancement or washout or enhancement similar to pretreatment. LRTR equivocal is reserved for the regions that do not fulfill either LRTR viable or LRTR non-viable. Let's see some representative examples. This is a case of LRTR non-viable. There is no tumor enhancement in intratumoral or abutting tumoral on arterial page, portavenous page, or delayed page. These are cases of LRTR viable. There is a nodular arterial page hyperenhancement along the treated lesions. Coagulation necrosis can be seen in the tumor as a high attenuation on pre-contrast CT and high signal intensity on T1 weighted image after RF ablation or cryoablation. In this case of cryoablation, you can see the expected post-treatment thin limb enhancement, and this is a case of LRTR non-viable. This is a case of LRTR equivocal. In this case, there is a thick peripheral irregular enhancement. This is different from treated specific expected enhancement pattern. That is thin uniform enhancement of surrounding parenchyma. You'd better follow up this patient to determine whether it is LRTR viable or non-viable. In this case of DAPT-AC, you can see similar imaging features of a previous LRTR equivocal case. However, after 8 months, this region shows no residual enhancement, and this is a case of LRTR non-viable. LRTRA has some unique features. First, contrary to RECIST-based criteria, which are per patient-based classification, it is a per-region-based classification. Second, observation can be categorized as equivocal when distinction between viable and non-viable tumor is challenging. With this LRTR equivocal category, specificity of LRTR viable category increases, but sensitivity decreases. LRTRA also adds new imaging features for the viability of HCC, enhancement similar to pretreatment. With this feature, sensitivity of LRTR viable category increases, and it is, this feature is especially helpful for evaluating local recurrence of LRM observations, such as cholangiocarcinoma. Also, LRTRA is imaging features for the non-viability of HCC, that is treatment-specific expected enhancement. It is a thin, smooth peripheral limb of enhancement surrounding a treated tumor with no internal enhancement. This feature is especially helpful after radiation therapy because this imaging feature prolongs more than 6 months in the case of radiation therapy of the liver. Let's move on to the second topic, the performance of LRTRA. These are the results of a meta-analysis for the accuracy of LRTRA category. Sensitivity varies between about 50 to 80%, and specificity is higher than the 90%. Among covariates, using imaging test as a reference standard shows significantly higher sensitivity than pathology as a reference standard and may overestimate the diagnostic performance of LRTR viable. Viability can be evaluated using different thresholds. Only LRTR viable can be considered viable, or either LRTR viable or equivocal can be considered viable. If we consider only LRTR viable as having viable tumor portion, the specificity is very high, but the sensitivity is suboptimal. If we consider either LRTR viable or equivocal as having a viable tumor, a little bit better sensitivity but less specificity are expected. Arterial phase hyperenhancement is the most sensitive imaging feature for LRTR viable. In another meta-analysis published by Korean authors, arterial phase hyperenhancement showed the highest sensitivity compared to the washout and the enhancement similar to pretreatment, but specificity was a little bit inferior. In this study, proportion of region with enhancement similar to pretreatment without neither arterial phase hyperenhancement nor washout was 0%. Therefore, the enhancement similar to pretreatment had a little lower as a standalone diagnostic criterion. In another meta-analysis, among three imaging features of LRTR viable, arterial phase hyperenhancement showed the highest sensitivity and washout was the second. Sensitivity of enhancement similar to pretreatment was very low. However, specificities of these three imaging features were similar. When comparing MRI and CT, sensitivity of MRI was better than that of CT. Unlike specificity, which varied relatively little across the studies, sensitivity of LRTRA varied widely across the researchers. This is probably because of ambiguous definition of viable tumor in LRTRA. These results suggest the need for further refinement of the criteria for determining LRTRA viability. Therefore, ACR is reorganizing the treatment response RIRAS work group and preparing a revised version of LRTRA. LRTRA can be used for prediction of survival after surgical resection or transplantation. In this study performed by our group, among patients underwent local regional treatment before surgical resection or transplantation, poor recurrence-free survival was reported in patients with LRTR viable rather than LRTR non-viable or equivocal. Let's move on to the last part of my talk, strategies to improve the performance of LRTRA. On MRI, atrial subtraction imaging can be helpful to detect atrial phase hyperenhancement. HCC is following local regional therapy present a bright appearance on pre-contrast T1 weighted imaging due to intratumoral coagulation necrosis. And this may hamper the detection of atrial phase hyperenhancement on MRI. Atrial subtraction imaging can improve sensitivity while maintaining specificity. The only pitfall of atrial subtraction imaging is misregistration like this. But according to the study by our group, the percentage of severe misregistration is about 2 to 3%. So that's not quite a big problem. In this study, sensitivity of atrial phase hyperenhancement for viable HCCs was superior in atrial subtraction imaging than ordinary atrial phase images. Also, diagnosis of LRTR viable was more sensitive than the atrial subtraction imaging rather than the ordinary arterial phase images without significant decrease of specificity. Arterial subtraction imaging is also helpful in CT to differentiate iodized oil and arterial phase hyperenhancement. Adding arterial subtraction imaging to the conventional CT images significantly increases the sensitivity without compromising the specificity of LRTR viable category. At this point, ancillary features are not considered in LRTRA. However, ancillary features can be helpful to boost the performance of LRTRA, especially in MRI. Candidates of ancillary features, MRTRA, include hepatobiliary or transitional phase hypointensity, restricted diffusion, and intermediate T2 hyperintensity. Similar to subtraction imaging, iodine map of arterial phase acquired on dual energy CT can improve the performance for detection of arterial phase hyperenhancement. Quantitative parameters of dual energy CT, like perfusion parameters, also can be useful for evaluating tumor viability after TACE. To address some of the issues I have mentioned, LRTRA 2023 is due out this year, and we were able to get a sneak peek at RSNA last year. The expected new definition of LRTRA categories for observations after thermal ablation or non-radiation intraarterial embolic therapy are as below. There are some important changes. The simplification of the definition of LRTR viable, and the detailed description of the treatment-specific expected enhancement in LRTR non-viable definition. Also, ancillary features can be used for upgrading LRTR equivocal to LRTR viable, and included ancillary features are restricted diffusion and mild to moderate T2 hyperintensity. This is the summary of my talk. LRTRA has some unique features. It is a region-by-region analysis. There is LRTRA equivocal for intermediate lesions, and treatment-specific enhancement is considered as non-viable tumor. In general, LRTRA shows high specificity but suboptimal sensitivity, probably due to ambiguous definition of viable tumor. There are some strategies to improve the diagnostic performance of LRTRA. Subtraction imaging, dual energy CT for iodine map, and adoption of MR ancillary features. And finally, new LRTRA system is coming this year. This is the end of my presentation. And finally, I would like to invite you all to KCR 2023, which will be held in Seoul this September. If you attend KCR, I guarantee you won't regret it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay. Next speaker is Dr. Jin Young Choi from Yonsei University College of Medicine, Seoul, Korea. He's going to talk about imaging evaluation of HCC after radioembolization. Dr. Choi.
Thank you, Professor Lee, for the introduction. It's my great honor to present in this global exchange program. I'm going to talk about the imaging evaluation of HCC after radioembolization. As some institution, radioembolization has become the primary therapy for patients with HCC in TARE. Radioembolic microsphere carry an isotope to the liver tumor via hepatic artery. The microsphere lodge at the arteriolar level and emit radiation through beta decay, serving as a focal point of radiation. Previously, TARE was performed in a LOBA or sequential LOBA manner for palliative care in advanced cases. However, current indication for TARE have expanded. Currently, the indication for the radioembolization include larger tumors, multinodular disease with more than 4 nodules, in presence of portal vein thrombosis, and non-responsive patient who have undergone TACE. Compared to the standard treatment for intermediate and advanced stage of HCC, radioembolization offer a similar survival rate. The legacy study was a retrospective multi-center single-arm trial involving patients with HCC who were treated with radioembolization. The study included patients with solitary HCC, smaller than 8 centimeter, and child A cirrhosis, and radioembolization was used as a neoadjuvant therapy for liver transplantation or resection, as well as a primary therapy. The study's result demonstrated that objective response rate was 88% and the duration of response was 6 months. Local tumor recurrence rates were low and comparable to the outcome of thermal ablation. This clinical trial demonstrated that radioembolization worked well in terms of clinically significant response and prolonged duration of response. The mechanism of radioembolization is primarily internal radiation, which causes changes such as size reduction, necrosis, and radiation effect on hepatic tumor. This reaction is similar to focal active radiation reaction, and radiation also induces inflammatory response in the treated area, making it difficult to differentiate between residual or recurrent tumor and inflammation. After radioembolization, several factors should be considered. The delayed response typically observed with a median time of 1 to 4 months. So it is recommended to start evaluation 1 month after treatment with multiphasic CT or MRI in 3 to 4 months time interval. Patch arterial enhancement is common and may be mistaken for an infiltrative tumor. Tumor may look heterogeneous due to heterogeneous vascularization, cell density, necrosis, and fibrosis of the tumor. And pseudoprogression, which may persist to 4 months, can occur 1 month after radioembolization. When evaluating tumor response to a radioembolization, size alone is not sufficient and should be evaluated alongside other imaging criteria. Necrosis is an important early indicator of tumor response after radioembolization. Occasionally, there may be a persistent enhancement on imaging, and histology may reveal complete necrosis. A thin beam of enhancement that surrounds the treated lesion is commonly observed in 1/3 of treated cases and should not be mistaken for residual or recurrent tumor. It actually represents an inflammatory reaction and fibrous tissue, indicating a favorable response. Nodular enhancement after radioembolization may suggest residual or recurrent tumor, but the presence of an enhancing nodule does not necessarily imply treatment failure. This study, the authors compared radiologic and pathologic findings in HCC patients who underwent radioembolization before surgical resection or transplantation. They discovered that complete necrosis was observed in 61% of the treated lesion, and lesions that were explanted in under 3 months had less than 50% of complete necrosis, while 68% of the explanted lesions over 6 months showed complete necrosis. Lesions that were larger than 5 centimeters had complete necrosis in 33%, while 65% of necrosis was seen for lesions measuring 3 to 5 centimeters. The absence of enhancement, thin enhancement, and peripheral nodular enhancement showed 100%, 93%, and 38% of complete necrosis, respectively. In this article, the authors checked how well gadocetic acidinase MRI could predict complete necrosis after radioembolization treatment. They found the percentage of tumor necrosis on subtraction image and EASL criteria were good at predicting complete tumor necrosis. Let me show you some representative cases. The first case is 57-year-old man who presented with abdominal pain. He had liver cirrhosis due to B viral hepatitis. On imaging, you can see a hypervascular mass in the right lobe and segment 4 of the liver. The patient underwent radioembolization. 1 month post-treatment CT showed persistent hypervascularity on the arterial phase. According to both RECIST and mRECIST guideline, this would not be considered a favorable response. However, on a follow-up CT scan after 3 months, imaging after 3 months, the tumor had slightly decreased in size and showed a non-enhancing portion, suggesting necrosis. Here's another example of TA Ali case. The baseline CT shows a hypervascular HCC in right lobe of the liver. However, unlike the previous case, the CT scan taken 1 month after TALE shows large area of necrosis and enhancing area. A follow-up CT after 3 months demonstrates a mixed necrotic and viable portion. Finally, 6 months CT scan taken before surgical resection shows a peripheral viable portion with a large area of necrosis. This is a gross specimen and photo microscope, and gross specimen shows a large necrotic area with a peripheral viable tumor, and photo microscope reveals an overall 70% of tumor necrosis, and here we can see tiny bits and viable tumor. Here's another TA Ali case. The patient had a big hypervascular HCC in right lobe of the liver. After 1 month, the CT scan shows that the treated lesion had necrosis, but still some areas that remained enhanced. According to RECIST and mRECIST guideline, this would not be considered a favorable response. 3 months after radioembolization, the lesion had shrunken in size and the enhancing area had decreased. However, there was still a nodular enhancing area at the lower part of the tumor. The patient underwent right lobectomy, and gross specimen shows large area of necrosis. Photomicroscope shows necrosis, tiny bits, and viable area. Let me show you the last case of radioembolization. We have a hypervascular HCC in right lobe of the liver on baseline CT scan. After radioembolization, 1 month follow-up CT scan shows a big area of necrosis. Although it wouldn't be considered a favorable response in WHO and RECIST guideline, it may be a partial response according to RECIST and LIRAD's guideline. As time passed and peripheral viable tumor has decreased in size, which could be considered near complete response. This slide shows that gross specimen and microscope, and the overall tumor necrosis was 80%. Traditionally, we use the RECIST criteria to evaluate treatment response by measuring the entire lesion. However, newer guidelines like EASL and modified RECIST focus on measuring viable area. After TACE or radioembolization, partial necrosis is common. So mRECIST is preferred for assessing treatment response after local regional therapy. I'd like to skip this slide because the Junil Choi covered this topic. The important point is that post-radiation treatment zone may have an equivocal appearance less than 6 months, and it typically takes more than 6 months for the treatment effect to become more apparent. TA early may cause tissue necrosis with no immediate change in tumor size. Therefore, the evaluation based on tumor size alone may not be adequate for follow-up. When the authors evaluated, compared these three criteria, the mRECIST and Choi criteria successfully identified the responder who had an extended time to progression, and there was no significant association between overall survival and resist mRECIST and modify the Choi response. When assessing the tumor response after radioembolization at the very early stage and early stage can be challenging, the radiation induced inflammatory response in the treated area, making it difficult to differentiate between residual or recurrent tumor and inflammation. Enhancing criteria could be a good way to predict survival early. The size criteria still has a role in predicting survival because a decrease in size and the whole lesion size suggests a favorable tumor biology. Since both the size and enhancement criteria are not enough to predict the outcome in very early stage after radioembolization, the researchers looked into functional and quantitative imaging. In this study, the authors aim to measure the amount of necrosis after TA-early within 1 month of treatment. They use the volumetric method to minimize variability, and the authors concluded that this method is useful in distinguishing necrotic tissue from viable tumor, and volumetric method is more reliable than 2D method. We conducted another study in our group. We wanted to see if we could use a technique, subtraction and mapping of necrosis to measure delayed necrosis and evaluate early response after radioembolization. We found that the patient with a bigger combined area of delayed enhancing and necrotic area, necrotic tissue, are less likely to develop local progression after radioembolization. The researchers in this article, the researchers found that mRECIST and ADC values change as early as 1 month after radioembolization. So it seems like using the functional quantitative criteria could be a useful way to see who's responding to radioembolization as early as 1 month after treatment. However, there was no imaging criteria. No imaging criteria was able to predict complete tumor necrosis. The optimal timing and criteria need to be determined, and in the future, the future research will be directed directly to measure the viable tumor, tumor cell, inflammatory activity, and potential necrosis to determine the treatment response. Correlation of tumor marker and imaging findings are necessary, and 3D measurement is preferred for 2D because the tumor are not spherical. With that, I'd like to close my talk. And I hope that many of the audience could attend KCL this year. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Choi, for your excellent lecture. So I'd like to introduce to you today's last speaker, Dr. Sang-hyuk Lim from Suncheonyang University, Bucheon Hospital. He will talk about imaging evaluation of HCC after local ablation therapy.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for kind introduction. It is great honor for me to be here with you, and thanks to ARS 2023 Organizing Committee for inviting me here today. My topic is imaging evaluation of HCC after local ablation therapy. I have nothing to disclose. Here is the contents of my topic. First, overview of local ablation therapy and imaging utilization for local ablation therapy. At last, radiofrequency ablation, recent trends in Korean Society of Imaging Guide Tumor Ablation about multi-operable clustered electrode on the mono and bipolar ablation mode and no-touch technique. Here are ablation modalities applicable to liver ablation. Among them, heat-based ablation, including RFA and microwave ablation, is most widely used. And lots of the research data about liver ablation have been accumulated by using these two modalities. It is well known that local tumor progression rate after ablation is higher than resection. However, for equal or less than 2 centimeter size HCCs, overall survival and recurrence-free rate, free survival rate after ablation and resection are comparable. We can make effort every time to create larger ablation zone because of these two reasons. This graph shows the correlation between main tumor size and the distance of satellite nodules. 2 centimeter or less than or less HCCs have microsatellite nodules within 5 millimeter from main mass. So the 5 millimeter ablative margin is sufficient for 2 centimeter or less size HCC, but bigger HCCs need larger ablative margin. This is the another reason that larger ablation zone because of these findings about microvascular invasion around the HCC. And this graph shows that higher cumulative early recurrence rate for the patients with high risk of MVI after RFA than surgical resection. Thus, when you're performing the local ablation procedure, we have to consider about the tumor size, shape, location, and which energy source will be used if available, if you can choose. Also, to find balance between sufficient ablative margin and remnant liver function is important. Let's move on to next topic. How about your daily practice? In my daily practice, we diagnose HCC using ultrasound, CT, or MRI. Here you can see 1.8 centimeter size single nodule HCC in segment 7 of the liver who had a history of previous hepatic resection. I ablated this lesion using a single electrode after the ablation, puncturing the center of the target lesion. And here is the result. The lesion ablated completely with sufficient margin. I think we perform similar procedure in daily practice using RFA and microwave ablation. Here are the key imaging features after local ablation therapy for HCC. We have to concentrate it on the nodular or irregular peripheral rim RFA with washout, and the size nodular RFA and of any size with or without washout or growth. The usual immediate CT findings after thermal ablation are hyperdense within the ablation zone on pre-contrast images, peri-ablated enhancement on arterial phase images, and linear ablation tract, air bubbles, and venous thrombosis. On immediate CT, usually you can see hyperdense lesion within the central portion of the ablation zone. It reveals coagulation necrosis, dehydration, and hemorrhagic product. I'd like to emphasize it, but not target tumor itself. It is not target tumor itself. In most cases, they disappear within 1 month. Also, you can see benign peri-ablational enhancement. It appears uniform, thin, peripheral rim-like enhancement on arterial phase images, indicates a benign physiologic response to thermal injury, and usually disappear by 1 month, but it may persist up to 6 months. Also, you can see a linear ablation tract here and here, also bubbles, but also you can see the venous thrombosis around the ablation zone. On MRI, coagulation necrosis, hemorrhage, and dehydration are demonstrated as hypo-intensity on titrated image and hyper-intensity on pre-contrast titrated images. On dynamic contrast enhanced MRI, hypo-intense ablation zone with marginal peri-ablational enhancement like CT findings, the subtraction images may be helpful in confirming lack of residual enhancing tumor. Geographic arterial phase hyperenhancement in the hepatic parenchyma is a normal finding and related to small arterial venous shunt generated during needle puncture. In this case, before ablation here, you can see the lesion on hepatobiliary phase images. There are hypointensity on T2-rated image, no restrictive fusion, hyperintensity on T1-rated image due to coagulation necrosis, and hyperenhancement peritumoral AP shunt, a thin arterial enhancement periablation zone, and there is no enhancement after ablation. We can use side-by-side comparison or follow-up registration and fusion. However, in my hospital, we cannot use those kind of programs such as fusion. Thus, we compare pre and post images side by side. We have to consider about remained enhancing viable HCC, achieved sufficient ablation zone, and immediate complication. I think multiplanar reformatted images are helpful, and consideration of different modalities, we have to think about CT or MRI and slight thickness. And also microwave ablation shows larger tumor volume loss after ablation. Here is a 1.1 centimeter HCC arterial enhancing lesion, and I performed ablation using CEUS, and I think it was not bad. on immediate post ablation CT, I thought this hyper attenuating lesion here as a tumor itself. But on the same CT, coronary reformative images, here is the ablated zone, and there was another arterial enhancing lesion. I'm mistargeting, I think. So, additional session of ablation was performed using contrast enhanced US. You can see the arterial enhancing lesion here, and the ablation zone was next to the ablation zone and another remained HCC, arterial enhancing HCC, and so I was performed another session of ablation. It's well known that fusion of pre- and post-treatment CT or MR image is most reliable method. In this article, local tumor progression rate was lower when using fusion imaging with additional treatment. On the follow-up images, ablation zone becomes smaller, and we have to find a later complication, including tumor recurrence. Once I studied about this study about the AI to find enhancing nodular lesion around the ablation zone using AI on arterial phase CT images, the area under the curve was 0.992, and in this figure, red square means candidate for local tumor progression, and white arrow means indicate portal vein runs around the previous ablation zone, cranial caudal reaction. We can use multiple electrodes in RFA. There's several advantages, such as more heat to the target lesion than sequential ablation, and may create an ablation zone close to sphere. This is the ablation modes, single monopolar ablation, and dual monopolar, and multiple bipolar ablations. When we using a dual bipolar ablation mode, shorter lateral ablative margins is acquired when using bipolar mode. Monopolar RFA cause centrifugal radiating energy ablation, and bipolar RFA can make centripetal energy ablation. Maximum amount of energy is activated, deposited in the margin. Further explanation may be that placing probes at the tumor periphery leads to the vessel coagulation around the tumor, thus limiting the intratumoral perfusion effect, providing a more homogeneous necrosis. Here is the no-touch technique that inserting multiple electrodes around the periphery and avoid direct puncturing of the tumor. And in this meta-analysis from Seoul National University, no-touch RFA showed better performance for local ablation control than conventional RFA. In this last case, there is a 3.1 centimeter HCC in left lateral section of the liver. At the time of RFA, the tumor was well visible on the corresponding fusion MRI. Inserted three electrodes, one by one with no-touch technique, and dual switching monopolar mode was applied. Echogenic cloud is generated around the tumor and switching bipolar mode. And during this resting period, about 3 minutes after, we can see the target lesion within the echogenic cloud, and we can replacing the electrode. So after repositioning, 15 minutes, 7 repositionings were performed, and echogenic cloud, we acquired sufficient ablative margin. So here's the result. The tumor was eradicated with sufficient ablative margin. In summary, recurrent HCC after ablation therapy is inevitable, so effective treatment strategy is required. Microwave ablation is much more powerful, and there are several advantages. However, RFA using multiple electrodes available tailored treatment is available with no-touch technique and combined monopolar and bipolar ablation. Thank you.
Thank you very much for excellent lecture. And I'd like to invite all six speakers to the stage, and then we can have a Q&A. Are there anyone from the floor who have any question or comments on today's presentation.
Yeah. Please come up to the microphones in the aisle. Same thing with the online audience. If you want to enter any questions online, we're monitoring the website as well. Yes.
Hi, Marta Braski from Boston. I have a question for Dr. Krajowski. Excellent presentation, thanks so much. It's in regard to the sarcoid-like reaction, especially when we are reading non-small cell lung cancer patients who are on chemoimmunotherapy and they have sarcoid-like reaction in the lungs. I find it very difficult to distinguish between pneumonitis, disease, and sarcoid within the lungs. I know you guys have a Dana-Farber great papers that talks about the oval shape and the patient not being symptomatic, but in real life, it's very challenging. So I wanted to know if you have other...
I agree. It is a very challenging diagnosis to make. Sometimes it has to be suspected. Maybe disease elsewhere in the body is responding to treatment, and you have some lymph nodes, sometimes above the diaphragm, sometimes below the diaphragm, that are increasing in size, which are in distinction with the other sites of disease. So I think having a very high index of suspicion is helpful. Also talking about it with the referring oncologist and getting their opinion on it, and having a close follow-up strategy. I think it's just the most important thing to have a high index of suspicion so that an effective therapy might not be completely stopped in such a patient. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I have one question for Dr. Yu. You mentioned about PSMA, PET-CT a lot, but what do you think about the PET-MR? I think MR is obviously better than CT for prostate imaging, and also diffusion may add some benefit for identifying lymph nodes.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. There are definitely advantages of PSMA MRI, especially for a primary tumor, because now you can evaluate the primary tumor. The problem is really availability. The number of MRIs, PET MRIs, are very few in the US, mainly at academic institutions. And at those institutions, they may do that, but the vast majority of, private practice groups or smaller institutions are not going to have PET MRIs, so they will have PET CT. And I think with the number of people who have prostate cancer, with the number one incidence, PET-CT is going to have the major role. But at a case-by-case basis, if you have that technology, PET-MR could be helpful. Some disadvantage is that it takes a lot more time.
Yes.
And you have to get the imaging algorithm. Is that better than doing a prostate MRI for the local versus a PET-CT? Mm-hmm. That's something else you have to factor yes. in as well.
Yeah. Thank you for the answer. Are there any questions or comments?
Are they doing it as a one-stop shop?
I don't know of many places that are doing it. I think majority of places, they're just doing PET-C. Well, I don't know if they're doing a whole body PET-MR. They may be doing, just a pelvis to look for regional. But if you're doing a whole PET-MR, that's going to take a lot of time as well.
Okay, please.
Yeah. Hi, Phil Kuo from Arizona. Two questions. First, I don't know if you can answer this, but I was wondering about the status of PSMA-targeted therapy in Korea, if it's widely delivered. And the second question, more for the radioembolization, if whether in Korea they apply the results from the dosisphere study where you're targeting, an index tumor to a really high number of gray. Thank you.
So as far as I know, there are several centers where the PSMA therapy is possible. So in Korea, definitely there are a few centers doing that therapy. And regarding the radioembolization sectionectomy or segmentectomy, it is quite commonly performed in Korea for the single tumors. Usually they love to use that for less than 5 centimeter size tumors. So As far as I know, the outcome is quite similar to surgical sectionectomy.
Can you comment on the supply chain issues with the PSMA therapies?
Yes. Unfortunately, there's only one place coming out of Italy that currently is producing therapeutic PSMA with lutetium-177. The only places that are doing PSMA therapy in the U.S. are basically the centers that were part of the clinical trial, like so UCLA, UCSF. You know, Dana-Farber was part of it. But I'm at a pretty big institution at Brown, and we have not yet done a lutetium PSMA therapy just because of lack of availability. We've been ready for 6 months. We've got it all through our P&T committee, and we're excited, and our GU oncologists are ready to go instead of me having to refer patients to Dana-Farber. But we have, unfortunately, the supply chain issues are really pressing. The good news is that there are going to be two places in the U.S. that are going to be offering lutetium-177 PSMA production, but that may not be until sometime this summer or in the fall.
I think at Boston Medical Center, we've started a few treatments, but then couldn't complete them because
couldn't get it.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So I think we were just beginning, and then unfortunately couldn't complete the course.
Any more questions or comments? I have a question for Natalie. So you mentioned that the near complete response. So when patients has complete response, we can choose a wait and see policy or surgical resection. But when there is a near complete response, what do you usually do?
Yeah, not me, but the team, they usually wait a little bit more because we know that we can wait until the cancer responds to radiotherapy, and around 90% of the patient with near complete, we ended up with complete response. So the thing is just wait a little bit more and check how the patient is evolving. And when, you know, if during the next 2 or 4 follow-ups, nothing changes or gets bigger, then the patient is rescued to surgery without any change in terms of outcomes, which is good.
Mm-hmm. What proportion of your patients that have a near complete or complete response are entering the watch and wait algorithm? And how does your center select which patients are candidates?
Actually, it varies depending on the treatment. If we are doing TNT, then the number will be a little bit higher. From our cohort, from the OPRA trial, was around 20%. And then from this, around 90% ended up with clinical CR.
Okay.
I have a question. In the US, interventional radiologists are often the majority of time authorized users. So they can administer the Y90 therapy. And then they also decide whether or not for hepatocellular carcinoma, if they want to do, radio embolization or they do radiofrequency or microwave. So they decide depending upon the characteristics of the tumor, if it's really hypervascular. How does it work in Korea? Because I know that nuclear medicine and radiology are not usually together. As an interventional radiologist, how do they work with the nuclear medicine physician to decide the the Y90 therapy?
We actually do that in the multidisciplinary team approach. In a conference, decide whether the tumor is appropriate for a candidate for radio embolization or surgical resection or thermal ablation, and the pre-assessment plan. In the pre-assessment stage, the nuclear medicine doctors involve before the treatment, and they may help the percentage of shunt or the nuclear imaging for assessment of metastasis or other information. And
the multidisciplinary team decide the proper treatment?
You know, I actually think that is the best way to do. And at Brown, we were one of the last places where we had the same approach. Mm-hmm. We had a nuclear medicine, because it used to be, until recently, the nuclear medicine was the authorized user. Mm-hmm. So the intervention radiologist would get access, but you know, I would be the one administering the therapy. But logistically and across the country, the interventional radiologist is the authorized user. That's much more practical, and that's the way we ended up going. But I think we lost a little bit because now you don't have as much discussion and have another perspective whether or not what is the most appropriate treatment. So, but I do like that approach.
So in Brown University Hospital, do interventional radiologists always perform biopsy before performing radioembolization?
Oh, to biopsy that it is a pathological carcinoma. So yes, pretty much. I don't know of a case that they haven't done at least ultrasound-guided biopsy or some kind of biopsy proving it's an HCC before they would, you know, give therapy.
Initially in Korea, we didn't do biopsy a lot, but nowadays we almost do biopsy before TARE. The reason for that is in some cases where TARE was not effective as what we expected, we found that those tumors are not HCC. So there are, although the LIRAD is quite work well when it comes to specificity, but still there is some percentage of tumors which completely mimic the imaging appearance of HCC. So nowadays we are doing biopsy.
This is biopsy during the same session as the treatment?
Same session, okay. Usually.
So it's retrospective. Yes. After the fact, you find out. In terms of MR imaging, which contrast agent have you been preferring? The hepatobiliary specific contrast agents or the non-specific ones? And how does that affect the LIRAD's treatment response scoring? Which have you found superior, in your opinion?
In Korea, we are using hepatobiliary contrast agents a lot, more than 90% of liver MR examinations. Yeah, please.
Yeah, actually, I can't understand your question because of the howling in this room. So, can you repeat your question again?
I was wondering which contrast agent was being used and why, and how it affects the LIRAD's treatment response.
As Dr. Lee said, most of the liver imaging, liver MRI is performed in Korea is using the hepatobiliary contrast agent. And we have some problems for the relatively poor quality of arterial imaging of the hepatobiliary contrast agent. So there's a little bit the hurdle of the adopting LIRAD in the daily practice. So, but I think that there's the difference of the point of view. The Western countries prefer the specificity rather than sensitivity for diagnosis of HCC for novel diagnosis or the diagnosis of recurrent tumor. But the Eastern countries prefer the higher sensitivity rather than specificity because the primary treatment modality in our country, in Korea, Japan, and China, are local ablation and then embolic therapy rather than transplantation. So we prefer higher sensitivity. So we prefer MR. Hepatobiliary contrast agent rather than the extracellular agent.
So when it comes to the local treatment response evaluation, I think hepatobiliary contrast agent may have weakness compared to ECCM agent. However, when it comes to new lesion detection, it has benefit. That's the major reason why we prefer to use hepatobiliary contrast agent. So if there is no further question, I'd like to conclude this session. Thank you very much for your kind attention.